Recording in progress.
Esteemed speakers of the day, Dr. Girija and Dr. Hema, moderator for the day, Dr. Akhila Mary Abraham, revered members of the school management committee, highly respected parents, principal Dr. Lena Francis, teaching and non-teaching staff members, and dear fellow students, a very happy evening to all. Puberty for a girl is like floating down a broadening river into an open sea. Puberty onset is associated with profound changes in drives, motivations, psychology, and social life. Hence, an awareness about these changes forms a vital part of education. And today, in Indian School LC, we are about to peep into puberty through the eyes of experts. Over the last 75 years, India has grown significantly across all sectors. India at 75 will be celebrating the Mahotsav, which will showcase India's accomplishments. As a part of the celebration, India at 75, Indian School LC, is organizing this talk show in order to create awareness among the young girls and educate them. Because if we educate girls, they will change the nation. Without further ado, let me welcome all to this informative and educational talk show. Dr. Girija, MBBS, DGO, DNB, MRCOG, obtained a medical degree from Government Medical College, Bellary. She did her post-graduation in obstetrics and gynecology from Mysore Medical College, worked as an associate professor in OBG in Kasturba Medical College, Manipal. Obtained membership degree from Royal College of Obstetrics and Gynecology, London, UK. She is currently working as a senior specialist in OBG in Sultan Qaboos University Hospital, Muscat, since 2013. She has 23 years of experience in the specialty. Above all, she is a mother of two children who have studied in Indian School LC. Her son Suhas AM, alumni of ISAS, secured free merit seat in NEET 2018. Welcome, ma'am. We are deeply honored by your august presence. And I'm sure all my friends are eagerly waiting for your perceptions on adapting to changes during puberty. Dr. Hema, MBBS, DGO, a gynecologist, has done her MBBS and DGO from NTR University of Health Sciences, Andhra Pradesh. Dr. Hema has been working in Oman since the last 16 years and has worked in the Ministry of Health and Ministry of Defense and is presently working in Sultan Qaboos University Hospital. Welcome, ma'am. And we are all ears to listen to you about the decisive phase that we are going through. It is with great pleasure that I welcome Dr. Akhila Mary Abraham, alumni of ISAS, who would be moderating the talk show. Dr. Akhila Mary Abraham, former student of ISAS, was the Greenhouse Vice Captain and used to actively participate in all arts and sports events. She is at present doing house surgency in one of the renowned hospitals in India. Welcome, ma'am. I would like to welcome all the worthy members of the school management committee who have rendered their valuable service and expertise in the ever-growing progress and development of the school. I proudly welcome all of you to this occasion. Welcome, sirs. I extend a warm welcome to all the beloved parents who have been supportive and cooperative, and one of the prime reasons for the success of all our endeavors. Leaders should influence others in such a way that it builds people up, encourages them, and edifies them so that they can duplicate this attitude in others. I respectfully welcome our visionary principal, Dr. Lena Francis. In the midst of these difficulties and crises, her vision and able leadership have encouraged us. Today, this talk show, A Peep into Puberty, Creating Awareness Among the Girls About the Changes and Issues Related to Puberty, is the need of the hour and a very relevant issue. And under ma'am's leadership, it is a very beneficial venture undertaken. Welcome, ma'am. I welcome all the staff members and students who are present here today. We do not grow when things are easy. We grow when we face challenges. Adolescence is a new birth for the higher and more completely human traits are now born. So let's enjoy our new birth under the guidance of experts. I'm sure after this session, all present here will be more confident and enlightened. Thank you. Now, I invite the moderator of the show, Dr. Akhila Mary Abraham. Over to you, ma'am. The platform is all yours.
Good evening, everyone. First of all, I'd like to thank our principal, ma'am, Dr. Lena, ma'am, and our my personal favorite, Danya, ma'am, for remembering me after all these years, and Dr. Girija and Dr. Hema. I don't know them personally, but they were all very helpful in organizing this show. So first, I would like to invite Dr. Girija for this for her session.
Hello, good evening, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Akhila, and thank you, Arani, for such a nice and extensive introduction about puberty. You made our job much easier. Okay, so this topic, as you know, we have selected this topic because this is not only useful for the children, but also, you know, awareness is very important for the girl child. As we know that today's girl is tomorrow's mother. That means the entire, if the girl is healthy, the family is healthy, then the whole nation is healthy. So it's very, very important to create an awareness, not only among the daughters, the young girl child, but also among the parents, the mothers who are taking care of them and also supporting them throughout their puberty. So coming to the topic, that is peeping into the puberty. Puberty, what is puberty? So we have to understand that puberty it does not happen overnight, does not happen in 1 or 2 days. It's a journey. It's a journey in which an young child transforms, a young girl child transforms into an young woman. So it's a transition from the girl childhood to the womanhood. So during this puberty, there are a lot of changes that do happen, not only physical, which we actually notice, but also there are a lot of other things, you know, psychological changes, behavioral changes, social changes, and all around changes happen in the life of the girl child. And this is a very vulnerable time where we need to support her both, you know, psychologically, not only by the parents, but also in the school, you know, by everybody. So coming to the changes in puberty. So I'll just, as you already know, so the physical changes in puberty usually, it can start anywhere around 8 to 9 years, okay? Because it might vary, like 8 to 9 years, or some children in by 10 years, the puberty changes usually start showing, okay? So what are the changes? Generally, when this puberty happens, it's happening, going to happen, the girl starts showing an increase in the height. Like, you know, we call it as a growth spurt. You know, you would have noticed, like, you know, suddenly, you know, they start increasing in height within a year or two, they become so tall, we can't recognize them when we see them after, you know, a year. Okay, so that increased growth spurt is the starting, the beginning of puberty. Once this happens, you know, later on, like, you know, the other changes also will be noted, like, you know, hair under the arms, the pubic hair, increase in the breast size. Okay, so, and, you know, also change in the shape of the body, presence of, you know, occurrence of these pimples, which are quite annoying during puberty. These are all the physical changes which do occur. Okay, so there are other some psychological changes which Dr. Hema will address later more in detail about the, you know, the symptoms and the regarding the menstrual symptoms and the premenstrual symptoms. I'll not go into that. Okay. So now you should understand that all these changes, you know, when they are happening in the young girl, because there are some hormonal changes which are happening. So what are those hormones? They're basically the estrogen, the female hormones, which are estrogen and progesterone, which are actually coming from the ovary. They are responsible for all these changes in the girl. Okay. So the end of puberty, usually, as I said, it starts around 8 to 9 years. And the end of puberty goes around, you know, about 3 to 4 years, sometimes even 5 years. And it's marked by the occurrence, the beginning of the monthly periods. So when the menstruation starts, it means the puberty changes are almost like, you know, finishing. The end is marked by when the periods start occurring in an young girl, which we call it as, you know, menarche, onset of the periods. Okay. So here you have to understand and know more about what is this menstruation and when does it generally start, when you should worry, when you should not worry. Okay. So I'll take you through the age at which the menstruation generally occurs. It usually occurs nowadays, an average age of the onset of this monthly period is 12 years, around 12 years, but it can occur as early as 9 to 10 years, or it may be delayed as late as 16 years. Okay. So anything in between these 9 years and 16 years, you should not worry, because I do come across parents who get panicked. They say, my girl is already 14 years old and the period is not coming. So don't worry. As long as you have noted the physical changes, puberty have already started. Like, you know, which I said, she's showing a growth spurt, or the hair is, you know, appearing under the arm. Okay, if there is increase in the size of the breast, these changes are noted. So don't be panicked. Just be patient. You can wait for another 1 or 2 years. I'm sure the periods are going to start. So when should you see the doctor? You should see the doctor if the periods fail to occur even after 16 years of age. So that's the time that we have to consult the gynecologist and look for the causes why it is delayed. Okay. So that's about the age. Then coming to the periods, these periods usually in the beginning of the, once the period start, like, you know, it starts around 13, 14 years, the initial 2-3 years of the periods, it may not be regular. It means that you don't have to worry that it's not coming every month. So generally 2 to 3 years, because the still the maturity of the reproductive system is happening. So it might take, you know, more time, 3 to 4 years of time to settle and the periods to become regular. So don't worry about if the period doesn't come like 3 months, don't worry. So just be patient. But if it continues to be regular, even after 18 years, you know, then that's the time that you have to consult the doctor to see, is there any reason? It could be, you know, sometimes like a polycystic ovarian disease. I'm sure you would have heard this many times. So we will look for the causes why it is regular. Otherwise, initial 2-3 years, you really don't have to bother about it. Just be patient. So then coming to the duration, what is the normal blood flow during menstruation? See, menstruation is something that is physiological. Okay, it's not thing anything that is abnormal. So this is basically the uterus, the womb. We call it as the womb, where, you know, it nourishes the baby. It prepares itself for the pregnancy every month. Okay, so when the pregnancy does not happen, the lining of the uterus breaks down and then comes out like a, in the form of a blood and sometimes some tissue. Okay, so it's like, you know, the breaking, it's something physiological when there is no pregnancy, because then it breaks down and then sheds its endometrium, the lining, and the period will come. So generally this period lasts for about 2 to 7 days. So which means anything 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So it's a normal, still within the normal range. But when it goes beyond a week, if the girl is bleeding more than a week during the period, that's the time you have to see the doctor immediately. Because somebody bleeds so long, it makes the girl weak, it makes her anemic, and it's definitely, it's not going to, you know, to be healthy in the long run. So you have to consult the doctor if the periods last longer than 1 week. So anything within that, you don't have to worry again. Okay, but one thing you have to focus here, the bleeding, what is normal amount of bleeding during the periods? What is considered as normal? As practically, you know, we all know that it's really not easy to assess like how much the girl loses the blood during the periods. But practically, like, you know, we can say if the girl has to change the pad every 2 hours, you know, because they use the sanitary pads during the periods. If she has to change the pad every 2 hours, which means like, you know, it's like a flooding. Okay, this is a very serious and she has to see the doctor because within no time she will drop her hemoglobin and she will become sick. So in that case, you have to immediately consult the doctor because this is not accepted as normal. So this you have to focus. Okay, so another question like, you know, we come across is the period hurts? Does it pain? Is it normal? The pain during periods is normal. Okay. Some amount of pain or a discomfort in the form of, you know, some crampy pain in the lower abdomen or in the backache on the first day or second day of the period is generally normal. Most of the girls do come across and most of them do tolerate it very well. And they cope up with very well without, you know, refraining from their routine work, like, you know, getting absent from the school. They'll do most of their routine work. They'll manage it well. So mild cramps is acceptable. So nothing more need to be done. Just a good reassurance. Just as a mother, you can, you know, reassure them. It's okay to have a mild pain and it's normal to have it. Okay. If it is more severe than that, if it is really affecting her, she can take even the, you know, the usual painkillers which are available over the counter, like, you know, Ponstan or Ibuprofen or something. She can take it for the 1 or 2 days during the period. Okay, this is also considered okay because most of the girls, you know, this pain during periods usually lasts sometimes even till the first pregnancy and the childbirth. Okay, after the childbirth, I have seen dramatically the pain disappears. So that is, so reassurance and some management with the painkiller should be okay. So when you should see the doctor? You should see the doctor if the pain during the period is so severe that the girl needs to go to the hospital to get the injectable, the painkiller injection. So that is considered as quite, you know, serious and severe. So it's better to consult the doctor just to rule out, you know, any other causes which are treatable and to get the reassurance from the doctor. So these are the few things, you know, about the periods that you should know. And you should also know that you have to maintain hygiene during the periods. And I see few questions, actually, we saw it in the in a question bank, like, you know, what can they exercise during period? So they are all okay. They can have a normal routine, whatever their work, they can do it. No need to, you know, shy away from doing anything. No need to refrain from doing your routine work. Okay. So nothing is contraindicated during the periods. You can do all the work, whatever, it's comfortable. And you have to be careful in using the proper use of the pads and also the proper disposal of the pads. So most of the time they use pads. But there are also available the tampons, the vaginal, they put the, you know, the tampons inside the vagina. Personally, I don't recommend this because it has to be changed every 3 to 4 hours. And in case it's delayed or forgotten sometimes, it can lead to a very dangerous infection. So personally, I don't recommend because, you know, they may not have a good awareness about it. So pads are more safer than them. Okay, I think I answered most of the questions regarding menstruation. So few questions about vaginal discharge, which I come across among my relatives or some friends. I would like to say a few things. So the vaginal discharge or the wetness, you know, the wetness, sometimes they feel wet in the underpants and they are worried about that. They think that it will make her weak. So remember, vagina is some of the glands there which secretes, you know, some secretions which keeps it wet. It is good because it has to protect, you know, has some lubrication there. It's like, you know, we have saliva in the mouth. It's similarly, it's some vaginal secretion is very much normal. It's physiological. Nothing to worry about it as long as it's, you know, whitish and little bit of mucus. And most of the times you find more vaginal wetness during the before the periods. Just before the periods, you might find a thick mucoid, mucus discharge. Okay, and also in the middle of the cycle, around 18th. Okay, 14th or 15th day of the cycle, this vaginal discharge, the watery discharge, because of the effect of estrogen, which corresponds to the release of the egg from the ovary, they might find more watery discharge from the vagina. Nothing to worry. Don't worry about this wetness and dryness. This discharge, as long as it is not associated with pain, or it is foul smelling, or it is greenish in color, or it is, itching or burning. So in those cases only consult the doctor. Otherwise, most of the times it's physiological, just a reassurance and nothing to be done. Okay. So before I conclude my talk, as a mother and as a doctor, I would like to give few tips to the young girls who are listening to me now. So I keep telling my kids also, I keep telling everybody. So, don't Google too much. Like any problems you have, feel free to discuss with your parents, discuss with your teachers, or even to the doctor. Don't Google too much and get panic and then have assumptions and get scared. Okay, Google is good, but you have to use it wisely. So before Googling, consult your parents and your doctor. Okay, don't self-medicate and get treatment on your own. And the other thing, as I said, the health is in your hands. Whatever you give will come back to you. So you really have to maintain a very healthy lifestyle, because I see kids these days, of course, I know it's because of COVID, everything is digital. So a lot of sedentary, you are not doing much of physical activity. Please, please, I recommend strongly, spend time outside the house. Go, play, run, cycling, swim, do something. Make physically yourself fit and active at least 30 minutes to 1 hour. Even parents, please take care that your child goes out to the sun, goes out to the open air and does some physical activity. Not only that, the balanced diet is important. Avoid junk food, because it's really not going to help you in the long run. Okay, so at least eat one vegetable and one fruit per day. I know children don't like vegetable fruits, but at least one, keep it like one vegetable, one fruit every day to keep yourself healthy and away from, all the diseases. Okay. And sleep. Sleep also is equally good. Don't compromise on your sleep. At least you have to sleep 8 to 9 hours. Be disciplined in your sleep cycle. Don't get into the late night, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock. This is a very bad habit. So maintain a very hygienic, sleep discipline. You have to be disciplined. Okay, so with this, I would like to thank the principal ma'am for giving me an opportunity to be a part of this wonderful evening. I hope I covered most of the questions. If anything are there, I'll be more than happy to answer them. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am, for that wonderful session. It was very informative. Now we'll have a talk session by our Dr. Hema.
Screen share చేయండి చాలా ప్రాబ్లం ఉంది
Am I audible, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am. Proceed.
Yes, ma'am. Please start.
Respected principal, respected teachers, parents, and dear children, I am Dr. Hema. We will discuss something about puberty. Don't worry, We are all very good. We will explain to you whatever you have doubts about. Okay, let us see. See, puberty. Oh my God. Ma'am, it is not going to the next. Okay. So, menstruation, we know, it is actually a phenomenon unique to the girls. But there are many misconceptions and taboos around it. So, these taboos, what they do is, they exclude the girls and women from many aspects of socio-cultural life. So, these taboos have an impact on the emotional state, mentality, and lifestyle, especially the health of the child. And also, it is compounded by the low knowledge levels of the child and low understanding of puberty. So, let us see some of the taboos. In many parts of India, culturally, we think that menstruation is unhygienic and unclean, which is actually wrong. They are not allowed to enter the puja rooms or into the kitchen. And it is also mentioned in Vedas that some of the guilt of Indra has been taken over by the woman. And that's why it comes out as periods monthly. But actually the science behind this, it is a natural part of reproductive cycle in which blood from the uterus exits through the lower passage. See, these girls in many parts of the villages, many parts of India in villages, they are kept outside the houses and they are not allowed to enter the houses. And also, some people believe in some parts of the country in India, we like people using the cloth for menstruation, they bury their clothes after using it, thinking that some evil spirit will see it and something will go wrong. And also, menstrual blood is believed to be dangerous. They think that a person can do harm to a menstruating girl through black magic. Maybe it will be good for a horror movie, but there is no logical or scientific explanation for this. Okay, and there are some dietary restrictions followed also during menstruation. We all think that sour food like curd or tamarind or pickles are not good during menstruation. But there is actually no restriction to any food during menstruation. And also, they think that women are unhygienic and hence the food they handle can get contaminated. As long as general hygienic measures are taken into account, there is no scientific test which has shown that menstruation can spoil the food. And also, we think exercise during periods can aggravate dysmenorrhea. Dysmenorrhea is nothing but the pain during periods. In fact, exercise can help resolve many of the symptoms like pain and premenstrual symptoms and bloating in the menstruating girls. This exercise releases some hormone called serotonin, which makes one feel very happy. Okay, if exercising was bad in menstruation, we would not have had PT Usha. She was the youngest sprinter to represent at the Olympics at the age of 16. There are also many, many women, sportswomen of India who have reached high peaks. If they had not exercised during their periods, they would not have reached these heights. They have to exercise every day. They have to go for training even if they have periods. And it is also believed that if a girl or woman touches a cow during her periods, cows become infertile. Cow, how, I really can't understand. Cow is an animal and girl is a human being. So when a girl is brought up under these circumstances, she thinks that I am not worth. And I tell you girls, you are all really very good and worthful. So what is the solution for this? The first and foremost thing we have to do is raise the awareness among adolescent girls and teach them about menstrual health and hygiene. Even adult women are many times unaware of the biological facts. And also they pass on the cultural taboos and restrictions. Mothers shy away to discuss these issues with them. The mother should explain to the child. She should not feel shy. And also teachers should spread the awareness among girls. It is science. It is nothing to be hidden. Science should be taught even when boys are around. There should not be any inhibition in discussing about menstruation. Improving the education of the women, empowering them and encouraging them to take in decision making will help to rule out all these bad things. Okay, coming to the cost of sanitary pads. Of course, sometimes when the income is low or the person has more children, the cost of the sanitary pads may be an issue. During these times, you can use low cost pads which are available actually to the poor people in India they are supplying, or also There is no harm in using a cloth unless until it is washed properly and used again. So, and also men and boys know very less about menstruation. It is important that they understand the menstruation and the problems and the physiology behind it so that they can support their daughters, wives, mothers, students, employees, and colleagues. Coming to the hygiene, one point in hygiene is when you are washing your private parts, you have to wipe from the front to the back to avoid infection. As you know, front part is the vagina, behind is the anus. So when you wipe from behind to front, it causes infections of the vagina. So it is always good and scientifically proven that you have to wipe from the front to the back. And also you have to change the pads frequently. If at all you are using tampons, you have to be very, very careful, because if they are left for a long time or forgotten, they can cause serious infection and also rarely deaths. Don't get scared. You can use them, but you should be very, very careful when you are using them. You should never forget them inside. You have to drink plenty of water. Share everything with your parents or mother. Children are the most valuable for their parents. So whatever it is, feel free to talk to your parents. Okay, this is for the mothers. You see signs of puberty in your child, but the period may be sometimes like it can come unexpectedly for the child. So the girls can get frightened by the sight of blood and the location. Tell her that one day she will get a period and that it is natural and that every woman goes through this. How can a mother support? Explain to her what is going on in her body. Menstruation can happen to any girl between the ages of 9 to 14 and the bleeding can last for 3 to 7 days. The period can be once in 3 weeks to once in 5 weeks. Everything is not same. So like suppose the child has a period on 1st of March, if it is a 3-week cycle, she can again have a period on 22nd. But if it is like on the 4-week cycle, she can have a period again on 29th of March. It is not hard and fast rule that it has to come on the same day every month. The gap between one period to two second period can be between 3 to 5 weeks. So now anybody we ask, 2 plus 2 is 4. It has to be 4. It cannot be something else. Because this is maths. Science is different. Two sisters don't have the same genes. Different girls have different genes. So all the children or all the girls do not attain menarche or periods at the same time. So don't worry. This is called mother's distress. If the child is not having periods, the mother gets distressed. So it's not required. You can wait. But if it is too much delay, you can see a doctor. So what she will need, the mother has to think to avoid staining of her clothes. She needs to have sanitary pads, panty liners or tampons. Nowadays, there are a variety of pads which are like different in length, absorbency and the thickness. The pad has to be changed frequently, whether stained or not. And there are special panties for periods. And sometimes when the child attends menarche, it may take 1 or 2 years for the cycles to become regular. Heavy or light, the child doesn't know. So what do you do about it? You observe the child. If you feel that the child is becoming sick or easily tired, there is no energy, unable to walk or climb stairs, think that maybe the child is having heavy bleeding. So then you take doctor's advice. Or you can, like when the child is changing the pad, when he's about to throw the old pad, you can just have a look onto it. So then you will get an idea. In her school bag, she can keep a pouch with a panty if possible, or 2 pads to help her when she has an unexpected period. Or she may carry medications also, like paracetamol, meftalspas, which is very commonly used. Or she can take the help of the school nurse. These panties are available to buy. Different types of panties are there with different linings. These are available in stores, or you can buy online also. So what are the common symptoms a child may have? She may feel uncomfortable for a few days before the periods. She may be moody. There may be cramps, pains. She may feel bloated or puffy. There may be breast tenderness. Tenderness means it is pain on touch. She may feel there is some swelling. She can have headache, back and leg aches, feeling like vomiting. These usually stop 1 or 2 days after the bleeding starts. So if there are any concerns, like there is severe pain or heavy bleeding is soaking the pad every 1 hour, every 2 hours, or bleeding for more than 8 days, bleeding between periods, then or periods are stopped totally for more than 6 months, then you have to consult a doctor for sure. So let us see how many of us are cranky. Premenstrual syndrome. This is a condition. It consists of symptoms where girls and women experience for 7 to 10 days before periods. There can be emotional symptoms like crying, crankiness, headache, body symptoms. Actually, 90% of the girls experience some kind of menstrual cycle discomfort, but 5% of them, like 5 in 100, may have severe symptoms. Then we have to consult the doctor. So in these cases, like if you have these symptoms, like getting so much angry, you are not able to concentrate on your studies, you are banging doors, you are fighting with your people, fighting with your family, yeah, you have to consult the doctor. In this case, you have to exercise, you have to take calcium in the diet, you have to take lots of nuts and fruits. It will help. But sometimes some children maybe have to take medications also. This is called premenstrual syndrome, where there are different symptoms: headache, nausea, vomiting, and all these things. So coming to nutrition and puberty, does nutrition play any role in puberty? Nutrition is one of the most important factors affecting the pubertal development. Consuming an adequate and balanced healthy diet during all phases of growth, infancy, that is less than 1 year, and after that in childhood and during puberty, this is necessary for proper growth and normal pubertal development. Girls enter puberty at an earlier age now when compared to past decades. Maybe excessive eating of many processed high-fat foods may be the cause of early puberty. This is not in one place. It is all over the world. The puberty has begun earlier nowadays. Overweight or obese children are more likely to enter puberty early. There is no harm in this. Severe malnutrition can delay the onset and progression of puberty. Coming to the height, some people had doubts about the heights and genetics. Scientists have estimated that 80% of an individual's height is determined by the genes inherited from the parents, and only 20% can be attributed to the environmental factors, mainly nutrition. And the height, once the child reaches puberty, the increase in height stops. Maybe after reaching puberty, maybe 1 or 2 inches they will grow. After that, they won't grow. Changes to the body and brain. Puberty brings a lot of changes for your child, physically, socially, and emotionally. Things that can impact on the child's mood. It can be due to hormones, lack of sleep. There can be peer pressure, school demands, conflict with family, feeling scared, stress, feeling self-conscious. All these things play a role in the changing behavior of a child. And some children feel shy. Maybe most of the teenagers feel shy. Why? Because the hormones are also acting on the brain. Feeling shy is not a bad thing, but it can arise from low confidence. It will interfere with their ability to communicate effectively. Why it happens? It can be like, maybe parents were also shy. The child has also got this same thing. Or maybe he had experience or she had experienced some negative experience by saying something. The child stops talking. Or overprotective parents. Children of overprotective parents can become shy. Build your child's self-confidence. What you can do? Opportunity to practice speaking. Suppose you go to a restaurant, you take the lead and tell, you order some food. Let the child take the lead. Let her speak. Let the child speak. Let them speak to other people. Encourage to involve in sports, clubs, organizations. Discover their talents. Provide opportunities to meet new people. What you can do? Maybe you can arrange small parties or weekend parties or get-togethers, sleepovers, and praise them and provide support. Teach skills, how to speak for themselves. When there is some injustice, they have to speak. Let them talk. And coming to the mental health, study on thinking disorders. India is the second most populous country in the world. Every fifth person is an adolescent between the ages of 10 to 19. A study from Lucknow estimated that the prevalence is the present status of mental disorders is 12%. Means in 100 people and 100 adolescents, there are 12 adolescent children who are having problems with thinking. 12 in 100 means 1 in 10. It is very, very common. So one child in every 10 adolescents will have a problem with thinking, maladjustment, or mood disorders. There was another study in Bangalore which revealed that the overall prevalence of mental disorders is 12%. Mental means it is not mad. Please try to understand. It is related to brain. It is not madness. Every problem has a solution. We have to do counseling. Discuss with the parents, teachers, please, children. If you have any problems, please speak out. Tell your parents, tell your teachers. Don't suffer. Take help. There is help available. Okay, now the child is at risk factors. The parents may have a doubt. When can I suspect that my child may be depressed? Okay, there are some risk factors. Like when you're going on a road, if you're going too speed, too high speed, there can be an accident. So like that, there are some risk factors for depression also. There is some family discord, instability. There are fights in the family, adjustment problem. There are addictions or there is bullying among the children. When there is physical, sexual or emotional abuse, child may not tell because she herself doesn't know that she is being abused. Or there is history of parental depression that can be carried through genetics to the child. Ethnic and cultural factors, like in some families, children, females are always suppressed. They tell them, you're a girl, just keep quiet and go. That these are all the risk factors for depression. How do you identify a child who has depression? You observe the child. The child may always feel sleepy. She may have anxiety, tension, unable to concentrate. Her mood is not good. There is no interest, socially withdrawn. She goes into the room, closes her room, poor self-esteem. She always thinks, I am worthless. I am fit for nothing. Fearfulness, guilt. She thinks that I should have done this. Oh, I should not have done this. Lack of enjoyment in anything. She's always bored, unable to sleep. Eating increased or decreased, antisocial behavior, fatigue, always she has pains, she is tired, thoughts of suicide or death. This is not only in girls, it can be in boys also. These are all the symptoms of depression. Then this child needs help. How parents should do, what parents should do? Talk to the child. How to talk? You have never talked to her, to them like that. Okay, when the child is angry, leave her alone. Sit with the child. Do you feel it is silly? No, it is not silly. Let them tease you. They may say, Mom, you have never spoken to me like this. What? This is new behavior. It's okay. This is your child. You have to take care. Ask her, is anyone scolding you or scaring you? What are your worries? If you are friendly with the child, she will open up. No help. There is no help. Search for the support. Talk to someone. Talk to some organization. There are many private organizations which can help children like this. There is a problem, get professional help. Talk to your pediatrician. See mental health professional. You can support your child. Spend some time, quality time with your child. Open an honest conversation. Don't act with them. They are very smart. They know. Honest conversation is very important. Listen to the child. Understand the inner struggles. Allow them to talk. Encourage healthy lifestyle. Exercise and sleep. Exercise at least 30 minutes most days of the week. You will feel energized and light. Parents can go with the child. Okay? You say no place, please walk in front of your house. You tell there is no time. No, there is time. Don't tell me you don't have time. Adequate sleep. Get at least 10 to hours of sleep. 8 to 10 hours of sleep. You will tell, if I sleep so long, how will I study? Getting enough hours of high quality sleep fosters attention and concentration, which are a prerequisite for most learning. Sleep also supports memory, problem solving, creativity, and helps in processing and judgment. Instead of doing this, you can sleep, get up, and then study. Be a strong girl. This is 2021. Girls are not just meant only to get married and have children and leave everything and take care of the family. Your career and happiness are the more important than any other thing. Okay, one of the most beautiful creations of Mother Nature is the girl who tries to grow up as a female, as a woman. Daughter was considered as a burden in olden days. But now we understand that girls and boys are the two coins, two sides of a coin. Kickstarting the right values from homes are the best methods to flourish the message of the need for equality, thanks to the education which is being provided nowadays. Jacinda Ardern, the Prime Minister of New Zealand, is the prime example of the power of women. Famous caregiver in the world, Mother Teresa, inventor of the windshield wiper, Mary Anderson, authors of the blockbuster books, Twilight, Harry Potter, The Hunger Games, inventor of the globe, Ellen Fitz, they broke all the stereotypes saying that females are only there to take care of the family and in the kitchen. this 21st century society needs creative women and men hand in hand for more development. There are so many famous females in the world. Famous doesn't mean only heroines. There are other things. Screen activity. Screens reduce the attention span. For brain to develop, it needs stimulus from outside. Screens remove the ability to control the impulses. It makes you forget how to rely on themselves or others for entertainment. They are always bored. Screens reduce the empathy. They inhibit the child's ability to read the faces. They only know one thing. Everything is weird. They think that weird, the word weird is stylish. They don't know more than that. Parents, please give time to your children. Study and play helps. Be a friend to your child. Don't be superstitious. Do not isolate the child during periods. Don't fight or beat the kids. Gain them through their love and patience. There are so many freedom fighters in India. Everybody is great. But we talk about Mahatma Gandhi more because he has chosen peace as his equipment. Ego will not help with the child. You have to be good to the child. Children should speak to their parents, share everything. They sacrifice for you, children. So it's your minimum responsibility to respect them and listen to them. Play every day or at least 4 to 5 days. Learn martial arts, karate or swimming. These will make keep you fit and also help you in self-defense. Observe your surroundings. Tell your parents where you are going, what you are doing. They are always caring for you. So let us see the video. Actually, what the child wants from us. My God. Okay. This is maybe this is you. Long back, you had your child. But then now the child has grown. You have also grown with her. Help her. The age, the gap has not decreased. The age gap, though, that time was 24, now also is 24. Give your experience to your child and help her in this difficult time. And children, please listen to your elders' advice. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am, for your enlightening words. Now I'd like to invite I'd like to invite Nishita ma'am. She's our school counselor. She joined in 2013. I left the school in 2012, so I haven't had an opportunity to meet her in person. But I'm sure during the past few days when we were organizing all this, I'm sure that she's a very approachable person, very helpful. So now over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Akhila. Very good evening to all. One second.
It's seen.
Good evening, all. Dr. Girija and Dr. Hema have immensely guided us about the different aspects related to puberty, and I'm sure which is highly beneficial for us. On the eve of India at 75 celebrations, it's a blessing to have an awareness session exclusively for girls. Over these 75 years, India has made remarkable progress for women empowerment. We Indians respect women as Nari Deva Bhava because we know education is the only key to empower girls. Puberty is a blessing, but adolescent age is a crucial period, whereas lots of hormonal, physical and behavioral changes can be seen in every individual. We should be more cautious to become safe during this particular stage. I would add few thoughts which can make you more safe and strong. Actually, no child should have to worry about her safety and welfare. But unfortunately, millions of girls around the world are at high risk for cybercrime, abuse, lack of access to good quality education, exploitation, domestic violence, acid attacks, a lot. Cybercrime is one of the most vulnerable one among all these stress, which mostly target females. During this unprecedented time, there is a significant increase in cybercrimes. According to a report by United Nations, about 60% of women across the world have faced some or other threats or some or other problems on social media. Based on the recent survey done by the Hindu Daily, it is noted that 80% of women are falling prey for cybercrimes, and most of them are not loading complaints. Now, let me ask you, our dear children, how can we safe or how can we stay away from trouble during online? Our safety is in our hands, but education and training can make you more stronger and safer. Education is not just going to school only or attending the online classes. It goes beyond that. I'm sure and all my children are following the online etiquettes. Anything you do on internet, first stop, then think, then connect. Please practice certain ground rules which can help to become safe always. Like, do not share your personal information and inform your parents if something makes you uncomfortable. Inform your parents before posting any pictures of yourself or your family members, or if you are downloading or installing any software, please inform your parents. Never respond to any messages to strangers. Never share passwords to anyone, even with your best friends, other than your parents. Follow the online etiquettes. Not to hurt other people, or not to do anything which is against the law. If you are ready to follow these rules in your life, you are safe. I'm sure you are safe. Another one important thing to remind all the girls here. As girls, you should learn how to bold or how to be strong to say no. If somebody is approaching with your wrong intention, it is not your mistake. It is a mistake of that person. So be strong and to say no. I know you can do it. If you need any help from our side, we are always there to help you. And other than from our side, BOD has initiated 24/7 telecounseling services for all the Indian school students. And the number for this service is 90-990-444. So help is always available. You don't have to worry. Now, parental role. It is said that God created mothers because he could not be present everywhere. It is not possible. We know it. So as a representative of God on earth, help your kids with love and patience so that the child will grow as strong adults. Educate your children about internet risk and dangers of internet. They need your support. Always have a positive communication with your kids. Allow them to express their feelings and let them see yours also. Teach them how to say no. Equip them to say no as a part of self-defense. We all face challenges in our life. When unexpected difficulties arise, be positive. Children notice everything. Set good examples for them and be a good role model to your child. They need to feel secure and stable at home. Let me conclude by saying, just as with everything in life, we cannot eliminate every possible risk associated with technology. But by using common sense and taking some reasonable precautions, we can greatly reduce our risk so that our children will be safe and they will grow as strong adults. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, our respected ma'am, for providing me such opportunity. And thank you, everyone, for joining with us. And thank you. Thank you once again.
Thank you, ma'am, for your words. Now, I'd like to invite our principal, ma'am, Dr. Lena Francis. I must say, ma'am, I'm so happy for this function. I should thank you for taking such initiatives. This is really, it's highly appreciable of you to do something like this. Over to you, ma'am.
A very, very happy evening. It's a unique session what is happening. Educate a girl, you're educating a family, then a society, then at large the nation. When India at the rate of 75, this year's theme is taken up as nation first, always first. I'm extremely happy to say that all the students and the parents who are watching us through Zoom and then through YouTube, I'm sure you must have definitely got a lot of information, which is very, very vital. At this juncture, I would like to say, nation first, always first. Here it is, girls first, always first. There is nothing simple about teaching students about sex. And we Indian parents, we are always a bit hesitant about talking about the sexual related matter. We feel that it is something which is beyond our cup of tea. We should not be discussing it about with our children. If we are not discussing them, they are finding their own ways and means of getting the information, which is not actually relevant. It could be even incorrect. This is a scenario wherein we thought of having a session only for these girls and mothers, which we'll be talking about the basic informations. And I'm extremely happy to say that the doctors, they are actually our parent doctors, and Dr. Aguila is our alumni. They have made this very, very clear. When we think about sex education, it's a high quality teaching and learning about a broad variety of topics related to sex and sexuality, exploring the values and beliefs about those topics and gaining the skills that are needed to navigate the relationships and manage one's own sexual health. These are all big, big things, students and parents. But then in a very, very simple way, two of our doctors and then one of our, yes, our alumni, she will be now leading the question and answer session. Dr. Aguila has done excellent work as a moderator. Now, immediately after me, I'll be inviting Dr. Aguila for taking over the Q&A session. So please hold on. Now, coming to the menstruation. As some of them have already spoken over here, it is never a curse. It's a blessing. Becoming a mother is always the blessing by the Mother Nature and the Almighty, I should say. First and foremost, all my dear mothers who are listening to us, you should be thanking the Almighty for becoming an excellent mother. You are blessed so that you are having kids. Similar way, girls, it's nothing to be scared of or worried about. It is a natural phenomenon what is happening, and then we are here to help you out or support you. And if you notice, ISI is always, in school LCB always, we used to have different kind of programs, information programs, awareness programs, motivational programs. So today is a day where we have been talking about a peep into puberty. Now, our first speaker, Dr. Girija, she's our proud parent. She spoke the transition of a girl child into a matured lady in a very, very simple way, as she is. I just gave only one phone call last week asking, ma'am, will you get time? In fact, she is on duty today, but she has taken off 1 hour and so that she could be there with us. And she explains in every point what is related to the puberty and then the menstruation. What is required for our children to know? A profound gratitude to Dr. Girija for being one of the panel members of this talk show and then kindly accept our virtual memento at this juncture to Dr. Girija. I hope all of you are clapping for her. I am not able to see, but then I'm sure that Dr. Girija, please kindly accept our very humble memento.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah. Yes. Next, I'm moving on to the misconceptions of menstruation. It was very safely handled by Dr. Hemavati. She's our Moksha. Moksha was her daughter's name, and then she just passed out last year. One of the good students of our school. And then, yes, Dr. Hemavati has made many, many, many important points clear to us. How important to prepare a girl child about the menstruation. How important the role of genetics, the cultural variation, the misconception, what runs in the family, in tradition, the right values of girls. Yes, as you rightly said, girls and boys are the two sides of coins. We just can't say that, yes, I have got only girls. Please don't say that. You have got all. They are the blessing by the nature. And it was a complete power pack performance. And then the information sharing, the knowledge sharing, Dr. Hema. I'm so happy I placed on record our sincere gratitude for rendering your time and effort. And you made an excellent PowerPoint presentation. I understand there were some more videos which you made. And I'm sure each and every one of us, whoever has been listening to you, they have definitely have made some profound memories. And then, you know, deep-rooted, they have got a lot of takeaway today. So thank you very much, Dr. Hema, for sparing your valuable time and sharing your thoughts. And we are so proud of both of our parents. You know, Mrs. Nishita, yes, she's our student counselor. She is a wonderful person. She used to always push me towards having conducting all these programs. And she has very amicably, very beautifully, in 4 or 5 slides, but she said the importance of safety, how well our children should be aware about what not and what is when they are in this online situations. Thank you, Counselor Nishita. Now comes our moderator, Dr. Nikhila. In fact, she is also on duty and she also has taken 1.5 hours off, and then she is there with us. And we always proud to project our students. They are in various professions and then they are always coming forward to help us out, becoming part of the school activities. And for your awareness, September 5th, we are officially going to launch our ISAS alumni. We have got almost 1,000 students who are enrolled. And when the school is approaching 20 years, we are stepping towards 20 years. And these are the children who are making us proud. And the enthusiasm what they always show when we are asking them to become part of it is amazing. It's phenomenal. So Dr. Aguila, thank you very much for becoming part of this. We are so proud of you. So with this, I would like to conclude. I just want to say one word again, start safe and then stay safe. It's 4S, start safe and stay safe, whether it is in terms of your biological aspects, psychological aspects, the safety aspects, always start safe and stay safe. With this, I request Dr. Aguila to take over the question and answer session. Over to you.
Thank you, ma'am. That is very sweet of you. Okay, now we'll move on to the question answer session. So any parent or students, if you have any questions, you can put the questions in the chat box. So we'll wait for your questions.
Dr. Aguila, you can also start asking questions, but we have already prepared and kept. Meanwhile, you can start asking.
Ma'am, my first question is to Dr. Girija.
Yes?
Yes, ma'am. I want to ask you, there's this people are aware about the cervical cancer vaccination.
Yes.
So I want to ask you if all girls have to take it or it's just... How is it? Can you explain?
Okay. Yeah, actually, this I was supposed to mention it. I don't know. I missed it. Anyway, good you asked me. This is, one of the vaccines. This is a cervical cancer vaccine, which is actually recommended widely in Western countries, like, US and UK. They are following a universal, like they're giving to all the girls in the adolescent age. So this is because, cervical cancer is one of the leading cause of the, death in women, actually, cancer death in women. So which means globally, every year, if you take annual death because of cervical cancer, we are losing almost 100,000 of women we are losing for cervical cancer. India alone is actually contributing to the majority of the cervical deaths which are happening. So this vaccine, which is actually, it is targeted against the virus because cervical cancer, the most common cause of cervical cancer is the virus. It's hard to believe. It's the papilloma virus. We call it as a human papilloma virus or a HPV virus. This virus is actually sexually transmitted. So generally it can be there. It is not harmful, but it can cause some changes in the cervix that in the long run, over a period of time, maybe some 10, 20, 30 years of a time, the individual, the woman can develop a cervical cancer. So that's why they recommend to give for all girl children during their puberty time. Like, you know, they can be given anytime after the age of 11 years. Okay, you don't have to wait for even menstruation. It can be given even before that or now after that. Anytime before they get sexually active, that means before they get married. So giving this vaccine once the, you know, the girl marries, or, you know, because I also hear, you know, a woman in 30s come to me and asking, can I get cervical cancer vaccine now? So this is not of much use. This is most effective when this cervical cancer vaccine is given before the girls, you know, get married. Okay, so it's around the cost of this is given in actually two doses at an interval of 4 to 6 weeks. Okay, and each cost of the each vaccine in India is around 3,000-3,500. Okay, the whole two doses, it will cost around 7,000. So I recommend all the parents, you know, to this, don't buy them an expensive mobile or take them for, you know, a trip somewhere and spend on that. Please give it as a birthday gift to your daughter, because these two injections can, you know, prevent the risk of cervical cancer. This is the biggest gift that you can give to her, you know, more than anything. Mobile will not last longer. So please, I strongly recommend all girls, adolescents to take this vaccine. And it's available in Oman also. So it's around, I inquired in one of the, it's available in most of the private hospitals, like maybe Star Care or, you know, most of the hospitals. It's around 40 to 50 riyals per each dose. So around 100 riyals, like, you know, you can get both the doses. But you have to check with availability, because if you are asking for it, they will arrange for it. It's available. And this, I strongly recommend the girls to take this vaccine.
Thank you, ma'am. That was very enlightening. Dr. Hema, ma'am, I would like to ask you, if a girl, even after reaching 14 years, she hasn't got her periods. So what should she do? What should a mother do in that condition, in that situation?
Madam, unmute. We're not able to hear you.
Yeah. So in this case, actually, it depends whether the child has other sexual characteristics or not. Whether she has breast development, pubic hair, axillary hair. If that is there, she can wait until 16 years, no issues. But if there is no sign of puberty, like there is no other sexual characteristics, then the child should be shown earlier to the doctor. Understood?
Okay, ma'am. Okay. Yeah, yes, ma'am. So we can wait till 16 years, right?
Yeah, we can wait till 16, yes.
Okay. And if a girl is having a heavy menstrual bleeding, like if the bleeding is so much, like she has to change one or two pads every 2 hours.
Yeah.
So in that region also, the mothers are, it's an usual tendency of mothers to get worried.
Yes.
So it's ideally, we have to consult a gynecologist, right?
Better to consult, because the most common cause can be some bleeding disorders also. Like the most common cause is actually anovulation, because they're not releasing an egg. So the progesterone hormone is deficient in them. But still, if the bleeding is too heavy, we have to investigate, because otherwise the child will become anemic. And also we have to rule out any anomaly, like bleeding disorders are there. Most common cause is von Willebrand's disease. Okay. So that we have to rule out, because it is a clotting factor problems and all. So that if you take care of that, so then the patient can be, child can be treated, investigated early. Okay. Yeah. Cannot hear. I can't hear you, Akhila.
Yeah, doctor. Thank you, ma'am. That was very helpful. Dr. Girija, ma'am.
Yeah, yes, Akhila.
I'd like to ask you, ma'am. You said you do not support, you do not recommend tampons, use of tampons. But yeah, we see in today's world, this use of tampons and menstrual cups and all, it's easy. What do you have to say about it? Is there any safety precautions that we need to take?
Because pads are like, you know, outside the vagina, and you know, they just absorb and they don't really cause harm, because these tampons are inserted inside. you know, little bit, you know, inserted inside. What happens is, see, vagina has a pleura and this acts like a foreign body inside. So it has to be changed very regularly. Like, you know, you cannot delay it. Delaying it will increase the risk of, you know, a bacterial infection, which can cause, you know, we have seen patients, the forgotten or delaying tampon causing a very serious infection. We have seen the patient, the girl coming in septic shock, you know, because of, you know, this tampon inserted and forgotten for, you know, long time and not changed regularly. So that's why I said, as long as you are not really, you know, comfortable or confident and very well educated and aware about using the tampons, especially the young girls, they don't know even how to use the pads. So I don't recommend them. Maybe, like, you know, as they grow older and they know the importance of that, they can still use it. It's not like, no, I don't say not to use it, but not for an young girl when still they don't know the seriousness of the condition. Pads are much safer.
Okay, ma'am. Yeah. It's understandable. Ma'am, another question that a parent has raised is, my daughter is only 9 years old and her breast enlargement is not normal. It's too early. Is it a problem to be considered or should she visit a gynecologist?
Yeah, breast, see, it's the beginning of puberty, usually starts with the breast. Maybe she still has to wait. Maybe, see, I said the average age, anything, it can vary from 7, 8, 9, even 10, 11 years. So maybe she's just 9 years. So wait for some more time and then it might start. So just to be patient, 9 years is too early, actually. We don't expect, you know, everybody to have and everybody to behave like a sign. Each individual is different. Don't compare with other children or others, you know, like this. So there is a range for everything. So you can really, you know, wait for another 2 years and see. Okay, so once, you know, usually it happens. Like as Dr. Hema mentioned, if these characters have a time to develop till the age of 14 years, it can develop anytime that. So if it doesn't develop beyond 14 years and menstruation does not happen by 16 years, that's the time you have to consult the doctor. Okay, so no need to be panic. You can wait safely up to 12, 13, 14 years. Nothing will happen.
Okay, ma'am. One student has asked if she's above 16 and still she has not got periods.
That's the time that she has to consult the gynecologist. Because we need to work up, you know, the causes. There are number of causes are there. We need to work on that. So she has to see the gynecologist for the blood test and some of the ultrasound and a lot need to be investigated.
Okay, ma'am. Yes, correct. Yeah. Ma'am, another question is there a cervical cancer vaccination available in Oman? For 10 years old.
Yeah, it's available in Oman. It's because I recently one of my friend, they got it from a Starcare hospital. They said most of the only thing you have to go ask them first, see the gynecologist, and then they will prescribe. Like, you know, they cannot just go and like ask for like a COVID vaccine. It needs a recommendation because even the insurance, I really don't know whether the insurance coverage is there or not. But it's available, but you have to tell them in early so that they arrange the two doses because they have to get it from, you know, it's not manufactured here. They have to indent and get it from elsewhere. But if you go and ask for it, they will consider, you know, they arrange for it. And one of my, you know, few of my, you know, friends' children, they got it. It's available.
Okay, ma'am. Can you say the name of the vaccine?
Name of the vaccine, ma'am.
Name of the vaccine is Gardasil and Cervirax. Actually, there are two vaccines available. The commercial name, the brand names are Gardasil and Cervirax. These are the two vaccines that are available for the cervical cancer. And each one costs around 45 to 50 riyals. But in India, it's around 3,000 rupees for each dose. They need two such doses at an interval of around 4 to 6 weeks. Gardasil and Cervirax.
Okay, ma'am.
There are some questions in the chat box there. They are asking, what happens if you are above 16 years old and do not have periods?
Yeah.
And if you do not go to the doctor, better go to the doctor. Though there are like major problems will be very less. Like in these cases, we will think whether the child has uterus inside or not. Okay, so then she will need to be having like an ultrasound should be done and some blood test will be done. And also if the child is 16 years old and has not got her period, we have to check whether she has any other male characteristics, like maybe excessive hair or hair on the lips or this thing, chin, you know. So intersex is very, very rare, but still, if the child is above 16 and she is not getting period, so better to check whether she has other sexual characteristics or not, and better to see a doctor. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
And actually, somebody is asking, what is period? Dr. Girija, you would like to explain what is a period and why only girls?
Girl, as Dr. Leena ma'am said, see, it's a boon to be a girl. Okay, and menstruation is not a curse. See, there is a uterus and it's lined, the lining of the uterus, every time once the girl reaches her menstruation, which means, see, she has a capacity of childbearing now. She's ready for the childbearing now. That's what the uterus prepares itself. Every month, the uterus prepares itself to harbor, harbor the baby and harbor the start the pregnancy. When this does not happen, the lining of the uterus just breaks down because the hormones which are actually preparing the uterus for the pregnancy, they no longer, continue to be secreted. So they stop their production and the uterine lining, broken and it sheds off like a period. Because there is a uterus and it's a period, it's to have a period, it's a sign of actually healthiness. You know why? Because as long as the woman is having periods, which means that she has that good two hormones, estrogen, which is secreted very well. The estrogen is actually it's a boon to the woman. It boon to us actually because it takes care of our bone health and takes care of our heart. And that's why you would have heard, cardiac, all these cardiac myocardial, cardiac angina, we say strokes, all these are less in women. Because this estrogen protects us from men. Men die more of, more early and more number of death in men is seen because of the cardiac problems. It is very less in women because of this useful effect of this estrogen. And this estrogen is responsible for menstruation. As long as woman is menstruating till the menopause, she is very much protected. Her cholesterol will be low. Estrogen will take care of her bone. The fractures are less. Once she gets menopause, when she stops period, then, all our risk increases. So we have to be happy that, the periods are coming, our hormones are in place, the system is in place. So we should think positive that it's a boon.
Just to add to Dr. Girija, this child would like to know why the word period. Because it comes once in 28 days. The child wants to know why are we saying it as period. So it is periodically appearing, regulatory intervals. Yes.
Okay. That may be the period, we don't use it in medical. Actually, it's a layman term. So yes. Medically, usually it's a menstruation. Period, probably it's a regular intervals of monthly, probably it's the name is given to that. Anyway, yes. Good. I'll also learnt it now. First time I heard this question.
Now, quite often we do say it as you say, the layman language, it's periods, are you in periods, is happening. So then the child would like, no, she's just only in class 5. He wants to know why this player is saying it's periods. Because it's appearing periodically, child. That is why. In 28 days, normally.
Correct.
Okay. There are any more questions, Dr. Agli, if we can look into our group.
One thing I would like to ask is how to deal with premenstrual symptoms, something that we see very commonly in girls these days.
Premenstrual symptoms, the main thing, first thing is conservative measures. You have to do more exercise, healthy diet, good proper sleep. But if it is not helping you, then you will be given some supplements like calcium and all. But if it is still not helping, sometimes we will have to put the child under antidepressants. Because the serotonin which is deficient in them is also in depression also. The serotonin is deficient. Okay. So the fluoxetine or some antidepressant which is working for depression will also work for premenstrual syndrome. Okay. And sometimes why it is happening? Because half of the cycle, now come to the menstrual cycle. The first half of the cycle, there is estrogen. The uterus, inside of the uterus is preparing for pregnancy. Then On the 14th day, the egg is releasing. Egg is releasing. Then the progesterone hormone is releasing. This progesterone hormone is causing these symptoms. So some people are very much sensitive to this progesterone hormone. Okay. So because of that, this progesterone causes more irritability, anger, and all these symptoms. So that's why the child is getting premenstrual syndrome. It is actually earlier, it was not seen in maybe young girls and all. But nowadays, we are seeing premenstrual syndrome even in young girls. So maybe the child will have to be put on antidepressants if it is too much difficult for the child to bear.
Okay, ma'am. Okay. Yeah. Yes, I understand. Ma'am, a student has asked, what is a tampon?
Tampon is a it's like a small cotton kind of thing, which is this much length, which can fit into your vagina. It's like a cotton. It's like a sponge. You can put it into your vagina and it absorbs the blood. So like you need not wear a pad. You need not wear a pad in the panty, which is like thick, no, sometimes. So you're wearing pants, you're wearing jeans and going out. So you don't want that to be looking thick. So this tampon can be put inside. There is no harm in virginity. Virginity is not lost because the hymen is told, hymen is the closing for the vagina. The vagina is closed by hymen, but there is a small hole, okay, which stretches. It is not an issue. The tampon is very small. It can go inside. So there is no harm in losing virginity or something. Can be used, but should be careful. That's all. This all came from the foreign countries and English countries. We, like in India, nobody used this. But maybe nowadays the teens are seeing the English people and all. There is no harm. You can use it, but should be careful. That's all.
Again, just to add to Dr. Hema. Just to add to Dr. Hema. Yeah. Earlier, probably in our times and all, we were not using this. Whereas nowadays, yes, these girls are they don't want that discomfort of wearing their sanitary pads, so that this will be comfortable for all their exercise and then movement and then all those things, dancing. So then it has become part of, some of them are using it. But then again, as Dr. Emma and Dr. Raji was telling, I suggest and advise not to go for it, if maximum possible. Though there is no well announced challenges, but then to be on the safer side, I feel it's not very highly recommended. And in the chat box, there is
actually like a big complication, like toxic shock syndrome. Like suppose it is left inside, the child forgets, because you never know. It is just inside, you don't know. Because there have deaths also happened very rarely in English countries.
I didn't want to say that, but then that's so why I was saying that to go for it. And ma'am, they're asking in the chat box, Dr. Girija, that name of the vaccine one of the parents is asking. Please kindly type in the chat box to everybody. If you can kindly look into it, they're asking.
Sure.
And then one more thing, they were also asking, I think, Dr. Agla, please continue doing it. Continue.
Yes, ma'am. So they say, we see girls eating various vitamins in the form of gummies or tablets for height growth and hair growth and acne. So should they consult a doctor before having all these?
Yes, always. Better to take the advice of a doctor, not to take anything like that. You know, a paracetamol can also cause complications. There can be liver failure. So whatever you are taking, we don't have any evidence. Better to consult the doctor and take.
If I can add again, everyone feels that Google is self-sufficient, where they can go get into it. They can get all the information and then they'll start medicating on their own, which is a very, very wrong practice. Very wrong practice. Doctors are required for us to give us the right kind of a tablet, the right kind of a medicine, and the right time, right way. It is, nobody can substitute. So whoever is listening to us, I just tell you, even if it's a paracetamol, the simplest thing what we feel, but it can also lead you to new complications. So kindly get the advice of the doctor and then do it.
Yeah, Google is always half knowledge. The people who are typing and writing in the Google, they are not doctors. They are doing their job. Maybe they are getting money. They are putting half of their knowledge. So it's not correct. Google is not correct. Please, maybe for little information you can take, but please don't follow it. Please don't follow it blindly. It is very dangerous.
Ma'am, another question is, can you explain what is a menstrual cup? I've heard it can be used for more than 10 hours. So is it safe to use?
Basically, see, we don't have that much knowledge about menstrual cup and all. But there are some teams who are using it. Actually, the manufacturer writes there is no harm on using. There is no harm also. Actually, to say, if you are using clean precautions and you are boiling it and using it, there's no harm. You can use it. But it has to be kept inside the vagina. If it's not clean, if you get some vaginal infection, then you are unmarried. Like, who will examine you? How we will know what infection you have inside? Then you have to expose yourself to the doctor. Inside, they have to check. All these complications, instead of that, what is the problem? I mean, you can use pads. It's not an issue.
Preferably, these kind of new things better to avoid. Yeah, another child is asking, is it necessary to use a tampon? No, we were telling not to use it or to minimize its utility. No. Yes, Agla.
Ma'am, another question is how to keep our genital areas, how to keep the hygiene tea?
Hygiene is nothing. See, you have to take bath once or twice, especially after you have played. Better to take bath, okay? And change your, like, even if you have not taken bath, for example, at least change your undergarments. You cannot use your undergarment for very long, like 24 hours, more than 24 hours. You have played, you have to come and clean. Any small, like vaginal discharge, normal discharge is common. But if, like, any yellowish discharge or you feel that it is itchy or smelly, so then you have to show to the doctor. And one more thing, do not use perfumes or powder or anything to wash that area. Don't use antiseptics. It is more harm. It is more harmful to use antiseptics and Dettol and all in that
Dettol,
case.
Dettol, yeah. I was about to say Dettol. Don't ever use it. It's a wrong practice we are doing it. Never.
Body has its own mechanism. The cells shed themselves after some time. So there is no need to put your hand inside and clean it and use some solution to clean it. It's God has given all natural defense mechanisms for the body. So need not worry about inside. Are we cleaning our intestines inside? No. God is like given that this thing. Science has created itself. So it is getting cleared. No. So why to put into the vagina? Nothing required. Just clean yourself. Take bath every day. That's all. And like suppose panties are very old, if they have become smelly, better throw them off and buy new panties. Or if you cannot buy so much, you can at least boil them in hot water and dry them in hot sun and then use it again.
Okay, ma'am. These days, panty liners, people are using panty liners. Is it safe to use panty liners every day?
Panty liners is not an issue at all. When you are having light bleeding, like on the first day, or the last days of the periods, or sometimes some people have intermittent spotting, like without period, they will have spotting sometimes. You can use no issues. But then change it. Change it after 3 to 4 hours. Just because it has not stained, don't keep it there only. You can change it.
Also, ma'am, when we use a sanitary pads, how much time is the maximum time that you can keep it?
I think 4 hours. Better to change after.
Always
so at least when you are in school from morning till afternoon, once in the major break, you can change it. Once in 4 hours, better to change.
Okay, ma'am.
I'm sorry. In between, I was told by this cramps, like no, some they do get like no, the stomach and then the leg and then. So, is it okay to reduce? I heard that the consumption of salt during that time, if you reduce, probably the cramps will come down. Something, is it any medical reason behind it or just a misconception again?
Uterus is contracting to stop the bleeding. Like it's trying to contract and stop the bleeding. So that is scientific. If the child is having more symptoms, yes, salt can be reduced. That is one this thing. Lots of water should be taken. Because of some electrolyte imbalances, the child can have more cramps. Some people have more cramps when they are dehydrated, they are not taking enough water. Better, like they can take coconut water, which can help. Minerals are there in that water. So that will help. Salt also can be reduced.
Okay, ma'am. Is there any issues in using intimate wash to clean private areas? You've already explained that.
That's what I said. Not to use. Please don't use. Don't use. Not required at all. They cause other different kinds of infection. They cause fungal infections. Bacteria goes, fungal comes. So better not to use them. Strictly.
I would like to just add something. You know, Dr. Hema rightly said, you know, this, see, we have some bacteria which are actually considered as good bacteria. You know, they are not bad. All bacteria are not always bad. So there are good bacteria which prevent the growth of other more dangerous bacteria and the fungus. So it's better to have them. Don't kill them. So leave it to the nature. Just a plain lukewarm water, you know, little bit. That's enough. No need of using any Dettol or, you know, whatever, these antiseptic lotions.
Ma'am, someone has asked, what is vagina?
It's a biological term.
Yeah, so vagina is a birth canal. So this is, you know, the outlet. Like, you know, we have, the gastrointestinal tract has two ends, like the mouth and the anus. So similarly, the reproductive tract, the uterus and the cervix opens to the outside. Okay, through the outlet. So vagina is actually the birth canal. No other way we call it as a birth canal. To which the baby comes out, and that's entrance. That's an entrance to the genital organs like the uterus and the cervix. It's just a roomy, you know, the space through which actually, you know, there is the uterus opens into the vagina. So basically, okay, it's a canal. It's a birth.
Not an issue, children. Okay, is it a parent or child? No problem. The uterus is there inside the pelvis, that lower part of the woman. Uterus, where the child is born, like the, while the child develops, okay? It has got an opening. Around that, this vagina is there down. It comes from the uterus outside. This is the organ where sex happens. This vagina, when you go up, there is a cervix and the uterus. So through this vagina, only sex happens, and the semen or sperm goes through this vagina into the cervix, into the uterus, and pregnancy happens. So it is just below the place where you pass urine. Urine, urethra is the point where you are passing urine. Just below that, there is another bigger hole, which is the vagina, which you go inside, actually it is bigger. Because the child has to come out through that if she is pregnant. Okay? No worries, you can ask doubts, no problem. When you go into higher classes, you yourself will know. But that is the just outside canal, which is inside going into the uterus.
Another organ where through which the baby comes, in other way, simple way. I think
Okay, ma'am.
Shall we wind off? I think almost we have answered almost all the questions, and we thought of having it for say 1 hour, but it's now 8:35. Sharp 7:30 we started our session, and still we are having another 66 students and probably parents, I don't know, they are there. So thank you once again for very patiently, very effectively, you have been answering to us. Beautifully well, Dr. Aguila has posted the questions, and Dr. Girija and Dr. Hemavadi, they both of them were really instrumental, like, you know, explaining to us the simplest way. And which is really highly, like, you know, very easy to understand for our girls of, say, age group of 9, 10 onward. They are there. I can make out the way the questions are coming, and we can make out. From class 4 onwards, we have been asking them to attend. Because just one question I saw in the chat was, at the age of 9 or 10, may I get? It's again depending upon the genetics of a child, whoever is asking. It's not a must that you'll be getting always after 12. It could be of even at the age of 9 also. So genetics and then different biological aspects. So then with this, shall we wind off? Shall we conclude? I don't think any more questions are there. So once again, a high level of appreciation for this kind of knowledge sharing, for sparing a valuable time to all the three doctors and dear parents and girls. I hope this is just a 1 hour, 1.5 session. It is not everything. Yes, we have started it, and it's a continuous journey again. And once again, our body is the greatest asset what the Almighty, the Mother Nature, has given to us. So as rightly all the doctors said, we have to keep them safe. Yes, and stay safe and stay healthy with this. I conclude the session. Thank you all. Good night.
Ma'am, I enjoyed the session, ma'am. Thank you so much. Thank you, really.
Oh, it was so nice of you. So nice of you. Dr. Girija, I know you're on duty and then I hope it's okay.
Thank you so much.
Her husband is covering her.
live and yes, YouTube.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
I can see here now. Thank you.